Good morning. Good morning and good morning, family of the Most High Yah. Hallelujah. We are here to celebrate the Most High, the creator of the universe, the first and the last, the beginning and the end, the savior of all mankind. Hallelujah. So we just want to thank you for joining us again for today's broadcast. We have just some exciting word to share with you, some encouraging word to share with you. And I hope that you have ears that have been anointed by the Holy Spirit to hear, and a heart that is ready to receive, because this is the hour of not only Israel's change and transformation, but for the nations. He's calling us to call the nations. Amen. So, Father, we thank you. We praise you, Allah. We give you all the glory this morning for everything, Father, that you have done and are yet to do. We thank you, Father, that you are shaking the nations, that you are destroying the very foundations of wickedness, and that, Father, you are calling yourself a righteous people, a people that will carry forth your name and your character throughout the world. Father, I'm praying for those who are standing, Father, and those who are fearful that they might fall, those who are fearful that they might not escape the judgments that are coming upon Babylon. I pray, Father, that you would let your spirit permeate their hearts and their minds, to give them shalom, to give them salama, to give them peace. In the precious name of Yahushua HaMashiach and all the saints, the Most High said,
amen.
Amen. Hallelujah. We just want to break down some things to you today. This morning, we've been kind of going over the salvation issue for Israel and for the Gentiles. And I hope that we've laid a good scriptural foundation for that, that this salvation was intended to the Jew first and also to the Gentile nations. It was supposed to come to us and then come to us and through us to the nations. Amen. That Yah had a plan. He had a purpose. And because we helped him in his work of bringing this good news to the world, we are going to receive special rewards and special placement in the kingdom. Amen. Remember, to whom much is given, much is required. And this is why we are in the predicament we are in now, is because we didn't take our responsibilities seriously. Our ancestors didn't, and we ourselves have not. This is why it's important to know who the true bloodline descendants of the nation of Israel are, because there were certain promises made to those specific people that Yah is going to bring to pass. And as those people, we want those promises to come to pass. Amen. We want the deliverance. We want the redemption that he promised. Amen. We don't want to always be on the bottom. We don't always want to be the tail. We don't always want to be poor. We don't always want to be last at everything in every arena of life, financially, emotionally, morally. Come on. We don't want to always be bankrupt. We want Yah to restore us. We want our positions back. Amen. We want that honor, that place of honor back. So we have to position ourselves to receive that place of honor. It's not something Yah just going to pluck you at random. You have to show forth the fruit of the kingdom. You have to show him. Amen. Let's just say he's from Missouri. You got to show him. You got to demonstrate that you have not only have head knowledge, but you are living out that knowledge. Amen.
Amen.
All right, we're going to go to the book of Deuteronomy, because as we can see, the book of Revelation is unfolding all around us. Even a blind man could see what's going on. We know that these different disasters that are taking place all over the world, that they don't report on our news channels. They don't report about rivers turning to blood. They don't report about the signs in the heavens. They don't report about these freak weather conditions, they call them. Amen. These anomalies, these abnormalities, these things are not normal. It's not right. And Yah is trying to tell the world things are not right. This is not the way things are supposed to be. And that means you need to make some changes in your behavior, because all these things are judgments coming from Yah. But the world is hiding and covering these judgments so that people won't find Yah. They won't seek a solution, because the solutions that man is offering, they're not working. None of their solutions are working. Their solutions with the so-called medications, their sorceries, are not working. Their financial system is not working. Their religious systems, they're not working. The proof is in the pudding. You know, it's apparent to everybody. It's not working. If religion is supposed to make you moral and upstanding, it's not working. If the financial system is supposed to benefit everyone, it's not working. Are y'all understanding what I'm saying to you today? So y'all trying to say, if that's not working for you, why don't you turn to the old landmarks? Why don't you come back to the things that your ancestors had? Your legacy is here. And we need to return to that old landmark and stop letting these heathen nations and pagan nations set the landmarks and set the boundaries, amen? Because their boundaries keep expanding and the goalpost keeps getting closer and closer. It's just, it's not the distance run. It's not the perseverance run that it used to be. It's now just do what you want. It's the wild, wild west. Morally, these nations are bankrupt in every area of life, amen? So as we talk about the nation of Israel and the awakening that has taken place, and after the awakening, the shaking that has been taking place all over the world, the 400-year prophecy that God gave to Abraham in Genesis chapter 15 is coming to pass right before our very eyes. And a lot of our people don't hear it. They're not listening. They're not receiving it. They don't expect anything different from Yah. They don't expect to be held in a special position or place. Are you understanding? And you can talk to them all day long and they still just, well, it don't matter to me. No, don't change my life. What that news, that message should change everything about your life. It changed mine. It turned me on a dime. I had to stop and say, this is not the right way to go. This is the way Yah has shown us to go. Let's go this way. Because there are many roads and they don't all lead to Yah. They don't all lead to the kingdom. Amen? Amen. So when we go to Deuteronomy chapter 4 and we look at how Israel, the nation, our ancestors, got scattered to the four corners of the earth, Yah also told them there's a solution already built in. There's an answer already been prepared for you. The same way Messiah died before the foundations of the world. He was already prepared because he knew we were going to fall into sin. He knew we were going to miss the mark. He knew we were going to break the commands. He knew we were going to do those things. So he already had a plan in place. So the same way when he said, when I scatter you, I've got a plan in place for your restoration and for your redemption, not only for the nation, but for us individually. He said, I got a plan in place to redeem you and to restore you. Amen. All right, let's go to Deuteronomy chapter 4. We're going to pick up at verse number 26.
I call the heavens and the earth as witnesses against you this day, that you will quickly perish from the land that you are crossing the Jordan to possess it.
Right.
You will not live there long, but will certainly be destroyed. The Lord will scatter you among the peoples, and only a few of you will survive among the nations to which the Lord will drive you.
What did he say I'm going to do? He said, part of this curse, if you didn't obey me, was you would be scattered among the nations. Many of the prophets said that you would be scattered to the four corners of the earth. That means all over the world. And where are we? Where are our people? Where are the only people that have been scattered to all nations, that have been transported in slave ships to four corners of the earth? It's our people. This right there, that ought to tell you everything you need to know. But Yah says, now that you're there and you're in this predicament, now you have this problem, I've already prepared a solution. I've already have an answer for you. Hallelujah. Amen. All right, come on, let's read.
There you will worship man-made gods of wood and stone, which cannot see or hear or eat or smell. But if from there you seek the Lord your God, you will find him if you seek him with all your heart and with all your soul. When you are in distress and all these things have happened to you, then in latter days you will return to the Lord your God and obey him. For the Lord your God is a merciful God. He will not abandon or destroy you or forget the covenant with your ancestors, which he confirmed to them by oath.
He said, now you find yourself on the flip side of the word. You're not on the blessing side. You're on the cursing side.
Right.
He said, you've been scattered to these nations. You're enslaved. You're oppressed. You're mistreated. You're abused. You're shot. You're incarcerated. You're all these things that the curse has opened the door for. And Yah says that when you find yourself, come on, when you find yourself in that situation, he said, if you will seek me, when all these distresses come upon you, these things are stressing me out. And I know they're stressing out a lot of our people because I'm talking to them. And they're stressed out by what they're seeing. They're stressed out by what they're going through. They're stressed out by their financial situation. They're stressed out by their emotional situations, their relationship situations. All these things are stressing, putting stress on us. When Yah wanted us to have shalom, he wanted us to have peace. And he said, now, when you find yourself without your peace, when you find yourself not being in a position of authority and power, he said, if you will seek him, what should you do? What's the solution?
Seek
him. Look for him. Seek him while he may be found. Because there's a time coming, saints. There's a time coming when you won't be able to find the word. You won't be able to find a more, a preacher, a teacher. You won't be able to find these things. You won't be able to hear this good news. And you need to take advantage of it while the opportunity exists. You're going to be like the virgins that came and knocked and said, hey, open unto us. He's no, I don't know you. The time to build intimacy and relationship and connection with the Most High Yah is now. While you're going through your trials and your tribulations and these distractions and these distortions and the deceptions of the enemy are permeating throughout the world, he says, now is the time to seek me. Don't say I'm going to wait and I'm going to do my deathbed confession. You know, that was my plan when I was a young man. I'm going to live like a hellion. I'm going to drink. I'm going to smoke. I'm going to chase women. I'm going to do all the things I want to do, all the bad things, wicked things that they say. You ain't supposed to do that. You know, I'm going to go do all those things. And then when I'm laying there and I'm 99 years old and I'm about to take my last breath, I'm going to confess my sins, the many, 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 many sins. And then I'm going to die and I'm going to go to heaven and say, I had a plan. And I talked to other people and they were saying, yeah, that's my plan too. But you don't know. It can happen in a heartbeat. It can happen in a second. It can happen before you can open your mouth and say anything. So this is why Yah says today is the day of salvation. Now is the acceptable time. Yahuwah is calling his people back to himself. This awakening is not a joke. It's not a mockery. It's real. And the timing of it happened just about the same time frame. The Holy Spirit started moving on everyone. And the people that didn't even know each other. There are people in different states and different countries that were waking up to this fact, to this truth of who we were as a people that had no connection with one another. So Yah's spirit is moving, but sometimes people don't hear the spirit. They don't listen to the spirit. They think, oh, that's not important. Oh, that's not relevant to this time and what we're dealing with now in this age, you know, but the scripture tells us that this is a promise that was forever to Israel. Forever. It had no end. There was no expiration date on the promises and covenants that he made with our ancestors. And that's why he's saying in this scripture here, if you will seek him, seek his face, know him. You know, we know a person by looking at their face. You don't know a person by looking at their hands, their feet, their backside. You know a person by looking at their face. You recognize certain characters and traits about their face. Yah said, I want you to recognize my character. Are y'all hearing what I'm saying? I want you to recognize me for who I am, not just my hand that gives you the things that you want and need. Come on. He said, I don't want you just looking at my hand. What can I get from y'all? He said, no, I want you to know my face. All right. When you're in those distressful situations like we're in right now, saints, what is Yah saying to seek my face? The pressure is coming to push you to the throne of grace. The pressure is coming to push you to your Savior, to your Messiah, to your Redeemer, to your Deliverer. You know, you'll never find him. Sometimes it's the problems that cause us to pray more than when we're having prosperous times and peaceful times. And right now is a very distressful time. Like Paul said, in the last days, it's going to be a lot of trouble and stress, trials and tribulations. He said, you've got to have a Savior. You got to have an ark. Come on. You got to have a fortress. You got to have a high tower. Come on, saints. You got to have a shield and a buckler. You got to have something and someone who's stronger than you, who's smarter than you, to do things you can't do. If you haven't learned yet, we have our limitations. Intellectually, we have limitations. Physically, we have limitations. You know, we're limited beings. We're finite. We need to go to the infinite. Abba Yah, we need to go to the infinite power, the infinite wisdom, the one who upholds all things by the word of his power. He said, I will never fail you. I will never forsake you. And that's what we have to remember as the nations go through their trials and tribulations and their judgments. We got to understand that we have to have somebody to hold on to, because that stuff is, we're going to be collateral damage if we don't run into the ark. If we don't run into our fortress, we're going to be collateral damage. That's why he says, come out of her, my people. You notice that when Babylon falls, the nations mourn. They're weeping, they're crying, but heaven is rejoicing. They're saying, hallelujah. Why? Because the wicked system, the wicked oppressors, the murders, the immoralities, all that stuff is falling. It's being judged. And Yah is being righteous. Amen. So what do we got to do? Seek him. Look for his character. Look for his will. Look for his way. Come on. And then Yah says, if you do that with all your heart, not half-heartedly, not a part of your heart, not a piece of you has an inkling of maybe, might. He says, no, you got to seek me with all of your heart. Why? Because James tells us that a double-minded man is what?
Unstable.
Unstable in all his ways. It affects your entirety of your life. A double-minded man, don't let that man think he will receive anything. Anything. I need healing. Anything. I need prosperity. Anything. You get nothing from Yah. You got to be focused. Why? Because a house divided against itself
will not stand.
And you are a house. You're supposed to be his house. And he's one. He says, hear, O Israel, the Lord our God is one. Then we've got to be single in our focus, single in our purpose. Come on. And all the enemy's trying to do is distract you, to divide you, so he can weaken you, so he can destroy you, because that's what he does. He comes to what?
Seek.
To steal.
Steal. Kill. And destroy.
All right. So that's where we're going to go to the next scripture. So Israel, we got to seek him. We're telling the other nations to seek him, but we're not even setting the example on seeking him. Are y'all hearing me? Because if anybody is under stress and under pressure and targeted, it's our people. And he's saying, if you aren't going to show people how to seek me and get deliverance, how are they going to see? How are they going to understand? All right, let's go to our next scripture.
That's Jeremiah 29.
Jeremiah 29, let's go.
11 to 14.
11 through 14. Ready?
Yes.
Go ahead.
For I know the plans I have for you, declares the Lord. Plans to prosper you and not to harm you. Plans to give you hope and a future. Then you will call on me and come and pray to me, and I will listen to you. You will seek me and find me when you seek me with all your heart.
Again, he's telling us, it's got to be all of our heart. What does Messiah say? What's the great commandment? Love the Lord with all your heart. Love Yahuwah with all your heart. What all means there ain't nothing left for nobody else.
Right.
Because that one love, come on, one love. All right, that one love, then it helps you to love your mother, your father, your sisters, your brothers, your wife, your husband. That one love, when you get that one piece of the puzzle in place, Yah says that it affects all the areas of your life. It's not saying, oh, I can't love nobody else because all my love's given to Yah. No, Yah opens you up and makes you bigger inside. He makes the capacity for your love to be greater. He makes it to your capacity for your love to be more sincere and pure and true. Come on. Because a lot of people say, I love you. They really don't love you. They love you today. They love what you did for them. They love the sweet, kind words you said to them, but they really don't love you. And that's the same way it is with Yah. Sometimes we love when he blesses us. We love when he's good and kind. But then when bad things happen, we curse him. And we can't send forth blessing and cursing from the same fountain. We can't do it both ways, y'all. You can't have heaven and hell at the same time. You can't have the world and the kingdom at the same time. You can't have, like my mother used to say, one foot one foot in heaven and one foot in hell. You got to choose. You can't straddle the fence, she used to say. And I used to say, what is she talking about? I don't see nobody straddling no fences. But she was trying to say you can't have half of you in, or a part of you in one world and another part of you in the other world. You got to be single. You got to be focused. You got to be committed. You have to have dedication. Other than that, your walk is not going to be fulfilled. It's not going to be successful. Amen?
Amen.
Jeremiah says it to us. When you seek him with all your heart, what are these pressures and stresses coming to do? Drive us to our knees, Israel. Drive us to our knees to call upon the Most High Yah to deliver us. Why? Because he wants to deliver you. He wants to show the world that his promises are true. He wants to show the world that he loves you, that you are the apple of his eye, his beloved. He wants to show the world. And we're not giving him the opportunity. So he's letting the pressures of the world push us to our knees, push us to our breaking point, push us past the point of no return so that we can say, Yah, we need you. I'm tired of these folks killing us, tired of these folks incarcerating us, tired of the oppression, tired of the racism. We're tired of it. And we're just to the point we're just through. We throw our hands up and say, well, there's nothing we can do. But we know that all things possible with Yah. All right? Are y'all starting to see where he's trying to get us to, the place he's trying to push us to? It's to seek him. Why? Because that's all he wanted from the time that mankind, Adam and Eve, fell in the garden. That's all he's wanted, is that relationship restored. So he began with you, his firstborn, his beloved, the apple of his eye, his chosen nation. It's royal priesthood. Come on. He said, I chose you so I could use you to get the other nations back to me. And the fact that you allow me to use you will then bless you. Because Yah blesses everything he uses. Remember the boat, the fishing boat, Peter's boat, I believe it was. He said, launch out. And he wanted to preach a sermon from the boat from on the shore. And afterwards, he told him, let down your nets. And they had a great draw fish. He blessed him for allowing him to use him. He will bless us if we allow him to use us. Amen. All right, come on. Let's go to the next scripture.
Well, you got just to verse 14.
Oh, go ahead. I'm sorry, I interrupted you.
I will be found by you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back from captivity. I will gather you from all nations and places where I have banished you, declares the Lord, and I will bring you back to the place from which I carried you into exile.
All right, that's where I was getting at. That, I'm thankful that you stopped me right there. The curse was scattering. The blessing is the regathering, the return, the restoration. So he's saying, my people got to start praying, because see, you're in these Babylonian nations all around the world. And he said, I'm about to judge Babylon. I'm about to judge this system. It will affect you negatively. It will impact your life. And so he's saying, you need to be praying and seeking my face so that I can bring you out of these places and back to the land that I promised to your ancestors, where you have a land that flows with milk and honey. There's prosperity there. There's peace there. There's going to be healing there. He didn't say you're going to not have any more problems. He said it, but you look at the problems you have now. He didn't say you're going to have no more issues, or there was no work to do. Even every time they returned from captivity, from exile, they had to rebuild. Hallelujah. So when we return, we're going to have to rebuild. Rebuild ourselves, rebuild our mind, rebuild our ego, our bodies, all this contamination, all these genetic experiments and diabolical devil evil ideas that they've been pushing into our head, into our body, into our spirit. It has affected us, infected us. And we have to be healed. We have to be cleansed. We have to be purified. Are you understanding? And these pressures are coming to drive us to the place where he can move us back to the place that he promised our ancestors. The motherland, the promised land, Zion. He's taking us back there to rebuild us as a people that will be the envy of all nations. I like the sound of that, because right now we're not the envy of many people. They envy our athletic ability. They envy our ability to sing. These different talents and gifts, they envy. But us as a people, as a culture, nobody wants to emulate that. Sagging. Women running around dressing like, you know what, Jezebels and harlots and stuff. He said, people don't want to emulate that. That's not the high standard that people are trying to achieve. All right. I hope you hear me this morning. We're going to go to Zephaniah chapter 2, verse 3. This is all about Israel being restored. And the nations of the world being judged, they're going to have their judgment, but they have their chance, their opportunity to be restored also. And there are many people in these different nations, these Babylonian nations, these wicked nations, these heathen nations, the pagan nations that still serve Yahuwah. They serve him. And he said, I'm going to bless I'm going to keep my promises and covenants to them. But the same way we got caught up in our ancestors' curse, some of them are going to get caught up in their ancestors' curse. And we love Yah as a people. We're some of the most religious, church-going folks, you know, givingest folks, some of the poorest folks, but some of the most giving folks. Talk about the billions of dollars that the Black church brings in every year. Billions of dollars that they bring in. And he said, and we're still not receiving those promises. Why? Because we've been lied to. We've been deceived. We haven't been taught his ways, line upon line and precept upon precept. All we get is a hoop and a holler and an A and a B and maybe a C selection and a prayer line and repent for the stuff you did last weekend. You know, come on. And then start all over again. There's no change, no permanent lasting change. From week to week, we're double-minded. We serve him, we love him, and then the next week, we're out there living like the heathens. Come on. And he said, we've got to be a steadfast people and serve him with all of our heart. We got to love him. And if we love him, we don't have no problem keeping his commandments. We don't have a problem walking the way he tells us to walk. We don't have a problem doing what he tells us to do. Why? Because he's blessing us. He's prospering us. He's giving us peace. Come on now. And he's going to restore our reputation. He's going to restore our legacy. He's going to restore all those things that we lost. You know, before the 1600s, before slavery, the kingdoms and the kings and the priests and the civilization and the social order and all that stuff that was going on that they don't tell nobody about. They start our history at 1600 slaves. You were a slave, period. There's no history before that. Well, who was before that? If we are the Aboriginal people, then there had to be, come on. There has to be history before 1600. If we're the Aboriginal people of the earth, there has to be history before 1600. What is the purpose of you only starting at 1600? To give us a slave mentality, to give us the oppression mentality, to say that we're only worth this. This is all that's allotted to us. The devil is a lie. Because there was a great history and legacy that came before that. And he don't want you to know about that, because he knows that if you start learning about that, you want that more than you want this current state that we're in. Say amen.
Amen.
All right. So Yah says, if you get back to me, then I'll give back to you those things that the enemy and the locusts have eaten and destroyed. He's trying to restore us as a people, and we're resisting him. We're fighting him. And we're saying, oh, we don't want to go that far. We don't want to be like those Hebrew Israelites. Oh, no, 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 no. We don't keep, we are Baptists. We always are Baptists. Oh, we Pentecostal. My mama was a Pentecostal. My daddy was a Pentecostal. And we're stuck in these denominational matrix that have our minds controlled and geared to religion instead of the relationship that we had through a covenant with the Most High God. Rules and regulations without a relationship. It's vain to worship him that way. It's empty to worship him that way. And that's why so many people are exiting the church. There's news all over the internet. You can find it. All over the internet, people leaving churches in droves. Why? Because they've come to find out it's vain, it's empty. The only thing that really satisfies you, like the Messiah said, come unto me. All you that thirst and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. You drink this water and you'll be quenched. You keep drinking that water, you're going to be thirsty in many different ways. Thirsty, all right? You're going to be chasing after everything, trying to satisfy something that only Yah can satisfy. For those who have, of us who have found him, we're like David's when he prayed, as the deer pant for the water, so my soul thirsts after thee. He's the only thing that we've found that can satisfy. You won't find it in some stranger's bed. You won't find it in some drug dealer's closet. You know, you won't find it in anything that's in this world. All these things are temporary, and they only provide temporary satisfaction. Nothing is going to be lasting unless it comes from the Most High. Yeah. All right. Next scripture. Let's go.
Zephaniah 2:3.
All right. Let's get read.
Seek the Lord, all you humble of the land, you who do what he commands. Seek righteousness, seek humility. Perhaps you will be sheltered on the day of the Lord's anger.
What? The judgment that's coming when Yah pours out his wrath on Babylon and on this Babylonian system, this Rome 2.0, all these sorceries and unbalanced scales, you know, where they're cheating people, where they're giving people something, a placebo, and telling them it's secure. All this stuff, he said, judgment is coming on it. Judgment is coming on these religious systems that men have instituted, men created, not the Most High Yah. Yah didn't come to start a church. He didn't come to start a denomination. He came to start a family. Hello. He came to start a family, and if you're tied in and hooked up in denomination, or you alpha, beta, kappa, and all these different things that men have instituted for you to put yourself into these cliques, in these cells, this isolationist, we're better than you, and that kind of thing. Yeah, I said, this is all about family. I'm building a family that's going to be in my kingdom and under my rule. And if we don't want to be family, we can't be in the kingdom. Israel was the firstborn among the nations. He said, you are my child. You are my chosen. And then after that, they're going to be a second, a third, a fourth, a fifth, a sixth. All those who will follow him and all those who will seek him, Yah says he will in no wise, no way cast out. So you need to understand, yeah, you may have been the firstborn. You may have been the first baby in the house. But that don't mean you're the only baby in the house. You're there to set the example and help with the other kids. Come on. That's what we did with our firstborn children. You know, when the third was born and the fourth was born, hey, go change their diaper. Go get them a bottle. Go fix them some juice. Go make them some dinner. Go rock them to sleep. Helping with the others. Setting an example of how this family works. Teaching them. Daddy said, if you do that, you're going to get it. You understand? That's the way we ran our house. We tell them, we hold you responsible if they do something wrong. Because you're here. We might be at work, but you're here with them. And you know the rules of the house. Somebody say amen in here. And you know the rules of daddy's house. You know his commands. You know what he expects. And if you sit there and just let things happen and let things go on and not speak up, not cry aloud and don't spare, don't hold back, don't bite your tongue. If you can't speak the truth in love, then you ain't no good to him. What the salt that has lost its savor, what's it good for? If you lose your ability to be used by Yah for the purpose that he intended, then what good are we used for? What good is there for us? You know, just say, we're Hebrews, like, but if you're not being used for the purpose that he intended, then what good are you? Nobody gonna sit there and shake salt on their food and they ain't getting salty. They ain't getting no change is taking place. Nobody gonna flip the light switch on and it don't work. Don't bring light to the house. Doesn't illuminate anything. Doesn't reveal anything. What good is it then? Why are you over there just flipping the switch? Some of us just flipping the switch. We're talking, but we ain't walking. We're not being living epistles and living examples of what Yah intended for us to be for the nation. It wasn't just so that we could walk around and pat each other on the back. It's so that we can reach those who can be reached. Paul said, plucking them out of the fire, you know, like a brand out of the fire. You got to get who we can quick, get them out, and then move away so we don't get burned. Now, y'all understand it? All right. Let's move on. He's trying to tell you the whole thing. The key to it is seeking what we lost. Remember, you lose something, you look for it. You lose something, you look for it. And so when you lost your Garden of Eden, when you lost your prosperity, and you lost your relationship with Yah, you have to go back and get it. Amen.
What one nigga won't do, another what nigga gon' do.
Oh, the enemy did.
I love you, don't always be forever. Don't you know I'm pressure, baby? These other niggas want you out the picture, they want me.
What the heck? Do you believe that enemy is busy today? That thing has never, that phone has never started just playing music all on its own. Just pick the song, start. And I'm sitting there going, we're sitting there going, is somebody's phone, somebody's phone ringing? That lets you know the enemy doesn't want this message to reach his people in this hour. Amen. So we need to stay focused on what Yah has for us to finish the work that he has given us to do. Amen. All right, let's move on quickly before that phone gets acting the fool again.
2 Chronicles 7:14.
All right, go ahead.
If my people who are called by my name will humble themselves and pray and seek my face and turn from their wicked ways, then I will hear from heaven and I will forgive their sins and will heal their land.
Again, seek his face. Seek his face. Turn to him. You need healing. We need healing emotionally, physically, financially. We're in need of healing in every area of our lives. And Yah said, if you would turn to him and seek his face, we've been turning to the government. We've been turning to institutions. We've been looking for the oppressor to heal us. We've been looking for the colonizer to heal us. We've been looking for them to restore us. And Yah said, they're not going to do it. You know, they're the ones that put you in the condition that you're in. You got to turn to me. And these other nations, after they're judged and they're stressed out and distressed and feel the pain, then maybe they will pursue him also. Amen. But we've got to show the way. We've got to light the pathway. It's like when I was walking up to someone's house one night, and they had this big home, but it was set far back in the street. And there was a long path leading up to their house. And they had these little lanterns, you know, along the way that lead you up to the front door. Well, if those little lights weren't showing you the path, you end up off in the bushes somewhere. You might fall off into a ditch. You know, Israel is supposed to be that light that's set upon the hill for the other nations to be drawn to worship Yah. Are y'all hearing me? Not so that we can light the path, so we can say we got the light, you don't got the light, we right, you wrong. That's not the purpose for us. The purpose for us was to point all nations and all people to him. All right, so we call, if we pray, his people, according to Deuteronomy and Exodus, we are the chosen people. Who are we? We are the chosen people. So when he says my people, remember there was no church in existence. Selah, think about that. We'll just pause and think about that for a moment. There was no church in existence. There was no denominations in existence. He was saying to these people, this is the covenant I have with you. If you call, if you humble yourself and pray, then I will hear from heaven. So that's what he's pressuring us to do. Seek his face, call on him, petition him, storm the gates of heaven and say, Father, we need your assistance. Bring the Air Force, bring the rain, you know, drop them judgment bombs so that these people will understand that there is a price to pay for sin. There's a price to pay for bringing pain to other people and oppression to other people and racism to other people. There's a price. We paid the price. Our ancestors paid the price. Now it's their turn to pay the price. And we have to watch, sit back and watch and say, now, watch and learn. Watch and learn. All right?
Amen.
All right, let's get to the next scripture. We'll finish this up.
Acts 17, and that's 22 to 31.
All right, go ahead.
Okay. Paul then stood up in the meeting of the Areopagus, and said, people of Athens, I see that in every way you are very religious.
Mm-hmm.
For as I walked around and looked carefully at your objects of worship, I even found an altar with this inscription, to an unknown God. So you are ignorant of the very thing you worship. And this is what I am going to proclaim to you. Okay, verse 24.
Mm-hmm.
The God who made the world and everything in it is the Lord of heaven and earth and does not live in temples built by human hands.
Mm-hmm.
And he is not served by human hands as if he needed anything. Rather, he himself gives everyone life and breath and everything else. For one man, he made all the nations that they should inhabit the whole earth. And he marked out his out their appointed times and their history and the boundaries of their lands. God did this so that they would seek him and perhaps reach out for him and find him, though he is not far from any one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being. And mm-hmm. some of your own poets have said, we are his offspring. Verse 29. Therefore, since we are God's offspring, we should not think that the divine being is like gold or silver or stone, an image made by human design and skill. In the past, God overlooked such ignorance, but now he commands all people everywhere to repent, for he has set a day when he will judge the world with justice by the man he has appointed. He has given proof of this to everyone by raising him from the dead.
God created all these nations. Elohim created all these nations. Give everybody their spot. He said, instead of seeking him, they start seeking after false gods, worshiping nature, rocks and stone. They were put everything up, stack up on rocks. Oh, mighty rocks. And oh, bless me. They started going after everything but the one who created. And he said, he created all these things for you to enjoy, not for you to worship. The worship belongs to him. Worship belongs to him. The Father seeks such to what? Worship him, not worship the ocean, not worship the moon, the stars, the sky, the fire, and all these things. He said, and Israel was placed here in the midst of all this perversion and paganism to say, no, this, we know who we worship. We know we worship Yahuwah. We know he's the only living and true Elohim. There is no Elohim, no God beside him. He said, so this was our purpose. He said, he created all men. Who?
All
men. He created all these nations. But he created a special nation in the midst of those nations to be the touchstone, to be the lead stone, the head people in charge. All right. So he says, but now he said, in times past, he winked at your ignorance. Say hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
He winked at our ignorance when our youth, the sins of our youth. He winked at those things. He looked the other way and said they just young and stupid. But now, same thing that goes with the individual goes with nations. He said, now he said it's time out for that. He's commanding every man, every people, everywhere, not just Israel, all people, all nations, everywhere to what? Repent. Repent from what? Sin. Well, what is sin? Transgression of the law. That means they don't have to have the physical written law in their hands to know right from wrong. You got a conscience. The Holy Spirit is there. Oh, I might get in trouble for that one, but he says that he has appointed a day. Judgment day is coming. And it's probably happening, transpiring right now. It's taking place. We see the precursor, the preview of his judgments on the world. The water's drying up, the fish, animals, birds dying. All these things that are happening, these strange weather phenomena, these UAVs and UAPs and all these UFOs and flying chariots and all these strange things that are happening. Skies turning blood red, seas turning blood. All these things that I'm just overwhelmed at how many things are going on around us that are fulfilling Bible prophecy. But Yah says, look, there's a day coming. There's an appointed time. And you got to be ready for your appointment. And I'm trying to press you. Sometimes I'm poking you and causing you pain to keep you moving forward. Because we will get depressed and we'll fall out and we'll lay out. I'm tired. I can't make it. Well, you know, if you ever watch those movies and there's a monster chasing somebody and they fall down and they're tired and they're like, come on, we can make it. And they're like, no, go on without me. You don't love your life. I am never that tired where I almost stop running from something that's trying to kill me. The enemy in this world, Satan and his seed, is trying to kill you. And here we are. We're tired. We're so tired that we just lay down and prepare to die. And that's not Yah's plan. His plan is that you live and not die. His plan is that you fulfill your purpose and you go to your ancestors. He said, you go to your ancestors and lay down in peace. And wait for the resurrection. Wait for that day to come. Amen.
Amen.
So I know that we all have gone through a lot of trials and tribulations, particularly specific families have gone through a lot of distress and stress lately and pain and loss. And we're praying your comfort. You know who you are. We're praying for your comfort. We're praying your strength in the Messiah. We're praying that you will be encouraged and that you will continue to keep on keeping on. And for those of you who've been on the battlefronts, you know, and fighting this lie and this deception, you know, we're praying for you. You know, we know how difficult it is to be the tip of the spear. We know how difficult it is to be the frontline soldiers. And it's going to be a challenge for each and every one of us, no matter what position Yah has placed us in. It's going to be a challenge. This battle that's coming is going to be a fight, the fight of our lives. And we have to seek Yah, and we have to have that connection and relationship with him in order for us to prevail, because the Messiah gave us a word where he said, pray that you be found worthy to escape all these things. Zephaniah told you that you might be hid in the day of judgment. You know, the scripture tells us, come out, come aside, go into your chambers, hide yourself for a little while the indignation is passed over. You know, Yah always wants to provide cover and protection for his people, but sometimes his people refuse his protection. People refuse his covenant and reject the protections that are written in as provisions of the covenant. We can't do that at this point in time if we want to be alive to fulfill the calling and the mission that's on our life. We have to come understand what he's trying to accomplish so that we can stand over our problems. We can put our foot on the devil's neck instead of him having his foot on our neck. Amen?
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Father, Yah, we thank you for this time. And I thank you, Heavenly Father, for demonstrating by your spirit that you are intimately involved in your people, the nation that you called and chose to be the apple of your eye, your chosen people. And I'm praying, Father, for them, the ones that are still out there, still walking around in ignorance, still walking around asleep. I pray for them, Father, that the scales would fall from their eyes. You would wake them up and they would come to understand their place in this battle. They would come to understand their purpose in your kingdom. And they would walk forward to fulfill that, to bring glory and honor and praise to the Most High Yah. To him we give glory. Amen. Amen. All right, family, y'all have a blessed day.